then. Hello! Welcome to Mastercast episode 57. Sorry for swearing. I don't even know why I bloody did that. Oh, God. What a palaver. Oh, you swore. Dickhead. Oh, I did it again. Hello! Welcome to Mastercast episode 57. How are you doing? Hope you are doing very, very well. And, yeah, hope you're having a nice weekend if you listen to this on the Friday that it comes out. Cheers everyone who's listened to the previous episode of the Mastercast. Much appreciated. I appreciate you a lot. You're all absolutely awesome. I love you. Yeah, we're getting close to that 60th episode, I guess. And how many plays have this podcast done so far? We've done quite a lot. The podcast as a whole has had 568 plays of all time. 568. That is pretty damn good. Pretty damn good. I'm very, very happy with that. It's awesome. It's awesome. We're at 57 now, and it's great. And I've got a good chunk to chat here about all stuff. Yeah? What have I been up to? Been doing a bit of recording. I've literally just finished recording a cover. And it's a cover of the brilliant track by Failure, Stuck on You, from their masterpiece album, Fantastic Planet, which came out in 1996, was it? I believe it was 1996. Unbelievable album. An album that a good friend of mine turned me on to. One of the listeners of this podcast, actually, Paul Guilfoyle, shout out. I just got addicted to this song at one point, and I was just like, I could probably try singing this. I could probably try it. And I've just done it. And it actually sounds okay, maybe? I'll let you be the judge of that, because what's going to happen right now is I'm going to let you fucking listen to it now. And, hopefully you enjoy it. If not, you can skip it if you want and listen to the rest of the podcast. But here it is. This is the first ever cover I've ever done with vocals, and it is Stuck on You by Failure. Enjoy!
We'll be right back.
107.9 FM. Anyways, yeah, that was a pile of shite. I hope you liked it. but yeah, I might start doing some more. I kind of enjoyed the vocal process. All guitars are done by me, bass, drums. Well, I mean, I edited the drums in because I'm not really a good drummer. But, you know, the guitars and everything else are all recorded by me, vocals recorded by me, all that sort of shit. There'll be a YouTube video up probably next week, hopefully. I'm going to try and do that. But yeah, it's on this lovely little podcast for now, and it might be on SoundCloud the next couple of days. So yeah, I hope you enjoyed it. Let me know what you think. If you think it's a piece of shit and I should stop doing it, tell me and I will stop doing it. Anyways, let's get on with the podcast. Enough about that. That's it. I hope you enjoyed it. Who tried getting the Oasis tickets? Who tried getting them? I did, and I fucking failed. And I just want to talk about Ticketmaster for a little bit, right? Because, God, it was a shit show. It was a shit show, wasn't it? Like, me and Haley and a bunch of people who I know attempted to get these tickets at literally, you know, signed in and everything at 8:45 in the morning, day of sale. And yeah, you know, we were there, we got put into a queue, and the whole time the website was crashing and there was an error, and some people got suspended because people thought they were bots because they kept refreshing. They did the same to me. Eventually, I got logged back in and put into a queue. I was behind a queue of 120,000 people. It was going on for ages. It was going on for hours, absolutely hours, to the point there was, you know, some people were lucky and got tickets, but by the time it got to the end of the queues, like, the only tickets available were these ridiculously expensive ones. And I just, you know what, the thing that didn't really piss me off was the state of the website or anything. I'm more concerned and bothered about these in-demand stand-in tickets that they've decided to throw in. Okay, so the stand-in tickets for Oasis were £150, right? Okay, already expensive. Okay, I know they're Oasis, I don't give a shit. Like, the £150 is a lot, and like, I found this out before the tickets went on sale, and like, part of me was like, fuck that, it's way too expensive, I could go to a festival for that price, you know? And other part of me was like, I can't believe Oasis are back together. I really want to go see them. This might be my chance. I might just go for it, you know? And to be honest, I'm kind of glad I failed in the process of getting tickets, because £150 is just one thing. It's one part of it, right? But later on, as the tickets started flying, they upped the price to £350, right, for a regular stand-in ticket. And they called it in-demand ticket, right? Which I think is an absolute load of shit, man. Like, what the fuck are they playing at, right? Live Nation and Ticketmaster are out there ripping the fuck out of people. Really, really are, man. Like, this is... it's scandalous. It's absolutely scandalous, right? You can't tell me that you should up the tickets by another £200 and say, oh, we've done it because they're highly in demand. Well, they were already highly in demand, so why are you doing it? It's because they want to make more money. It's as simple as that. Is it squeeze every last bit of cash out of everyone's pocket who just wants to go see live music, right? It's fucking bullshit. It's really, really fucking bullshit, man. Meanwhile, there's loads of grassroot venues. Music venues with loads of bands, small bands playing, starting out. And, you know, a lot of them are struggling. A lot of them are closing down. Some of them are voluntarily run, you know, like, just to stay open. And, you know, Ticketmaster would rather get all the money out of all these people wanting to see Oasis out of the pockets and just give it to themselves for greed and for profit. It's the way these fucking stadium gigs work. And it's shit, really. It's really, really shit. I mean, I don't know what it was like for Taylor Swift. Apparently, Taylor Swift was, like, insane for tickets. I'm really, really mumbling my words up here. But, like, it's fucking bonkers, man. It's bonkers. And it's not just the ticketing websites as well that are going mad for it. Like, you know, booking.com. We looked at hotels and stuff like that in Manchester for one night. Literally just one night only. And it could be anywhere in Manchester, okay? The very least we could find a hotel for was £350, right? I looked everywhere, right? That was the very least you could get a hotel for in Manchester, right? They knew Oasis was going to be in town that night. So they thought, right, let's fucking milk it. So let's say you've got yourself a fucking Oasis ticket, £150. And then you have to, and then you unfortunately have to go, all right, okay, I guess I'm going to get this Travelodge or whatever from booking.com for £350. And, you know, that's £500 already. Especially if you just got the bloody in-demand ticket. That £350 plus £700, man. It's insane. And, like, you know, it's absolutely dog shit. It's absolutely dog shit. I mean, look, I mean, Oasis are great. I love them. Like, hundreds of thousands of people love them. They don't need this much money. They really, really don't. If they needed this much money, nah, they fucking don't. They don't. It's fucking madness. It's absolute madness. And, you know, I'm good. I'm not going to be able to see them. I really am. But, you know, I'm kind of glad I didn't get tickets because, you know, there's, you know, you think a ticket, you travel, you mega expensive hotel, you might want to get some merch there, have a couple of beers, have a bite to eat or something like that. You're looking at hundreds just for one day. Like, you can literally go on holiday for that much. It's insane. Like, I wish they just announced a bloody Newcastle date like most bands would. So, like, you know, I don't have to think about hotels and travel and all that sort of shit, man. It's, yeah, it's quite gutting, but yeah, I just wanted to vent a little bit about Ticketmaster and Live Nation because they're a bunch of robbing bastards and they just don't think about the punters who are there just to see some live music and have a good time, right? They just want to squeeze every last bit of money out of them. And, you know, it's you just think, like, well, who are the staff at Live Nation and Ticketmaster? Aren't they regular gig goers? How would they feel having to pay all that much for a band? You know? Bullshit. It's absolute bullshit. But yeah, that's it. They have announced two more Wembley dates, and that is ticket ballot only, which seems like a good idea, really. Like, it's stopping any touts from getting their hands on tickets, which, by the way, is another thing. Touts have managed to get hold of Oasis tickets at a charge and thousands for them. You know, which do not do. That is a very idiotic thing. And to be fair, Oasis as well, like, they've actually turned around and said, if you want tickets, use a website, Twickets, if you want to get one for face value. Don't go to the touts. Don't go. They're setting the record straight. I mean, but at the same time, you're still charging a bit much for a ticket, aren't you? Still charging quite a bit, Oasis. But yeah. Anyways, there's two more Wembley dates. I'm not even going to bother. Because if that's what it was like for Manchester, the price-wise and all, having fucking hell. Wembley is going to be a whole kettle of fish. Let me tell you about that. Anyways, enough about that. Slam Dunk have announced some bands. They've made their announcement for next year. And I tell you what, already, it's way better than last year. My God, last year was an absolute pile of garbage. Like, so bad that I didn't even go. And, you know, it was quite gutting for me because I've always thought Slam Dunk is a good day out. I've always loved it. I might have said that on the podcast before, but, like, Slam Dunk is always a great day out. Even if there's just a handful of bands that you want to see. Like, It's good. If the sun is out and you've got a few beers and you're out with your friends and all that, go see a few bands. It's great. It's good. And, like, you know, I like Temple Newsome as a ground. I know a lot of people are like, nah, take it back to the city centre. Why? So you can queue more. Fuck that. Slam Dunk have announced the bands, and headlining is going to be none other than A Day to Remember, which I kind of had a feeling they would do at some point. I don't mind A Day to Remember. I used to love them back in the day, like, you know, early to mid-noughties and all that, like, you know, Homesick and Common Courtesy, and especially What Separates Me From You. I love that album. I think they kind of took a bit of a dive after Common Courtesy. I wasn't all that in on Bad Vibrations, and the last album wasn't good at all. I kind of grown out of A Day to Remember a little bit. Last time I saw them was Download Festival, which was 20... When did they play Download Festival last? It was either 2022 or 2019. I can't exactly remember. It just felt like I didn't remember by numbers. Like, I've seen them just play way better. They just didn't look as enthusiastic. But I think them headlining Slam Dunk were going to get a way better set. I don't remember headlining. I think that'll be a good headline set. I think that's cool. I was actually listening to a bit of A Day to Remember the other day, just kind of get me in the mood for it, and I was happy about it. Yeah, cool. Alkaline Trio also playing the festival. Also, before I mention any more bands, there's no sort of indication as to what bands are going to be headlining, whatever stages or whatever, or what stage some of the lower bands are going to be on, or anything like that. It's literally just a poster full of names, so that's it. But there is quite a few big names on here. I'll say that for sure. Alkaline Trio, big fan of those. They're a really great band. I love them first two albums. As It Is, nah. Delilah Bourne, I do not know who that is. Electric Cowboy, they're fucking great. I would imagine they would headline like the metal stage. Electric Cowboy are really good fun. I saw them at Slam Dunk a couple of years ago, and they were fucking awesome. And they're damn right hilarious. That album that they brought out a couple of years ago was fucking great. I really enjoy it. Graphic Nature I've not heard much of, but I've heard good things. I might have to give them a go. Hot Mulligan, they played Outbreak this year. Kind of more on the sort of whiny pop punk thing, which I'm not really into. Knuckle Puck, and has Copacetic underneath, which I assume is an album anniversary show of some kind. I don't know anything by them. Look at me fucking reading band names of and going like, I don't know who that is. Less Than Jake, I think they're kind of one of the more alright ska punk bands. Whenever they come on Kerrang Radio, I don't mind them all that much. Mouth Culture, Movements, Neck Deep in a big massive font. Neck Deep, I imagine, would be headlining a stage. Either that or be high up on the main stage. Who knows, we will see. Straight From the Path, Get In. I love that band, absolutely love them. Just full of great albums, always amazing live. Craig Reynolds, just an unbelievable drummer. Just unbelievable musicians, really. Just incredible. Don't care who it's going to be on. Same time as them, I'll be watching them for sure. Newfound Glory, and they're always a good time live. I remember seeing them the first time supporting Green Day on the American Idiot Tour in 2005. And I've seen them a couple of times since then. Like, I've seen it, funny enough, I've seen them support A Day to Remember a few years ago, and they were awesome then. And I've seen them play Slam Dunk, they were awesome then. Split Chain, I do believe they played Outbreak this year, but I didn't get around to seeing them. But I know they're part of that sort of like grungy hardcore movement. So I'll have to give those a listen. And The Ataris, The Starting Line, The Used. I can imagine them headlining a stage of some sort, like, because they're right at the bottom of the poster for some reason. But to be honest, I think like the whole poster is like a hodgepodge of just names everywhere. Of course, Zebrahead are back, aren't they? Because they play every fucking year. If you listen to this, day comes out, the tickets are on sale at 10 a.m. Of course, if you listen to this podcast after 10 a.m, they're on sale now. Best of luck getting them and all that. It starts off super early bird, then it goes into early bird, then it goes into general admission, then the final few. And VIP upgrades will go on sale later in the year as additional add-on. But as the lineup as a whole, like, it's fine. I think it's fine. Like, I think there's enough on there for me to go, yeah, I'll go to Leeds for the day, have a good drink, see some bands, see Strafe in the Path, that sort of thing. Electric Cowboy, Alkaline Trio, Newfound Glory, reminisce a little bit of Dirt Remember. You know, like, it's a decent lineup. I think it's fine. Like, I've been to way better Slam Dunks, and I've had way better, like, initial reactions from other, like, announcements, you know. So this is fine for me. I'm happy to go, definitely. So I'm gonna be getting the ticket tomorrow, like, when, as I'm speaking to you on this podcast, on the Thursday. And I will get tickets, baby! Yeah. So yeah. Good luck to everyone getting tickets. I'm sure you'll be fine. It's not gonna be like Oasis. I think ever since Oasis Gate, I'm gonna call it that. I've just been like, oh god, good luck getting tickets for anything now. But yeah, Slam Dunk 2025, bring it on, and bring on the bees. I'm already off on that day as well. Lands on my day off. Fucking happy days. And also, new album from Nails. I gotta recommend this one for sure. There's not much else. Well, not much other music I've been listening to recently. Nothing new. Although this new album by Nails has been my gym fucking soundtrack. It is 17 minutes long and contains 10 tracks of pure, all-out punishment and violence. It is fucking lovely stuff, this. Absolutely lovely stuff. I've been a fan of Nails for a good few years. I love their albums, especially You Will Never Be One of Us, which was the last album that came out. They've had a bit of a lineup change. A couple of the members have left, and like, he's got a couple more now. And like, Nails were on a bit of a hiatus, but now finally we've got an album called Every Bridge Burning, and yeah, they came back of a couple of singles, like one of them called The Imposing Will, which is the opening track of this album. And honestly, the millisecond you are pressing play on this album, you are hit with a guitar tone that is like a chainsaw grinding against a jet engine, like, all over this album. It sounds nasty, it sounds destructive, it's horrible, it's beautiful. Ah, yeah, this album's a fucking great time. It's awesome. I think I prefer the last album, to be honest. You Will Never Be One of Us, but this album is still really fucking great. I love it. Imposing Will is just fast as fuck, like, until it goes into like a full-on like double bass 4/4 stomp groove, and just like, whilst you're being pummeled to death by riffs, it just goes absolutely hard as fuck. My favorite track on here, track 4, Give Me the Painkiller. It's like a fucking speed metal song. It sounds like a Judas Priest riff, like, just sped up, like a, give me the painkiller, like, and his voice just sounds like he's gargling actual nails as well. Like, it is fucking wicked stuff. But like, it's got, for a grindcore band that has got like this sort of really, really heavy sort of distorted vocal, like, it's got a hook, it's got a hell of a hook, it's awesome. And lacking the ability to process empathy, the fifth track has got this fucking awesome groove, like, at the beginning of it, like it just, it's just like, it was one of those, it's like stank face on headbanging fucking wicked shit. Like, I was having this on at the gym, and like, just like, I'd just be walking around nodding my head and just like pulling the fucking face, looking like a fucking weirdo. And finishing off the album as well, No More Rivers to Cross is just like a fucking stoner metal track. Like, it really, really cuts down on the pace, and like, it's just really sludgy and like slow and moody and horrible. No More Rivers to Cross, it's brilliant. This album's fucking great. Like, oh, there's literally one song that's above 3 minutes, and that is No More Rivers to Cross. Like, most of the other songs on here about the minute and a half. Some of them are about 2 minutes. Given the painkillers, about two minutes 45. You got one song on here called Trapped that's 38 seconds long. Ah, this album's just fucking, it's lovely stuff, man. It's heavy as shit. If you want some all out aggression, violent metal, like if you've been pissed off today at work or whatever, anything like that, or you just want to fucking hit the gym, just like smash some weights, go fucking mental, listen to this album, Every Bridge Burning by Nails. It is an absolute barnstormer of an album. It's fucking great. It's really, really awesome. I love it. Anyways, what we been playing? What have we been playing? Been playing a bit of video games and all that sort of shit. I don't think there's been anything as of news, really. I'll tell you what I did get myself, though. I got myself one of those PlayStation Portals, and I'm telling you, they're fucking great. They're really, really fucking great. I've seen a lot of people have bought one. I know, and I mean, I kind of sound a bit hypocritical, because I talked about the announcement for the PlayStation Portal a while back, and I remember looking at it thinking, I don't think this is for me, this. I don't see the point. But now, it's come to my attention that it looks really good. Really, I guess. Well, basically, what's happened is a lot of people has picked a PlayStation Portal up thinking it is a brand new standalone PlayStation handheld system. People are going to be picking it up thinking, oh, I can download God of War on this, I can download Elden Ring on this and play it on the fly. That's not the case. This is a streaming device. You need this to connect to your PlayStation 5 via Wi-Fi so that you can play games online. And, you know, I was aware of that from the announcement, of course, but a lot of people weren't. And a lot of people have been selling them. Like, they're everywhere on Facebook Marketplace, on eBay and all sorts. And, like, a lot of them barely have a scratch on them, honestly. Like, the basic description I've seen on a lot of these has just been like, oh, excuse me, I've got it. A lot of people have just been saying stuff like, I thought it was a handheld console, made a mistake, selling it cheap. And a lot of people are selling them pretty cheap now, and it's good. You should have a look. I really recommend it. So what I've done is I've took it to work with me, and bearing in mind my job hasn't got the greatest Wi-Fi signal at all, so I thought I'll give it a go. And I was playing some games. I was playing a bit of Helldivers and stuff like that, like on my PlayStation Portal through the work's Wi-Fi, and it worked insanely well. It worked incredibly well. Like, I was really, really surprised with the results I got. Like, I was like, I had like the odd glitch here and there, but genuinely, like, it was really fucking bang on. It was like, it's awesome. It's an awesome piece of kit. Like, and you get the full haptic feedback on the controllers as well. Like it just works insanely well. It's really, really impressive stuff. And yeah, I'm really, really enjoying using it. It's good. It's really, really good. Yeah. Fuck yeah. PS Portal is great. I played some Resident Evil 3 recently. In fact, not played a bit of it. I played all of it. I fucking finished it, right? You know what? Like, people weren't kidding, man. Like, this game is fucking short, right? I did mention that it was free on PlayStation Plus a few months ago, so I downloaded it then, but I hadn't played it since. But like, I was what happened was I was actually waiting for Final Fantasy 7 Rebirth to arrive at my house, because I ordered it off eBay, and it was taking a lot longer than I thought. So what I did, I just thought, I'll just give Resident Evil 3 a go. And what happened is, like, I basically played a good chunk of it on a late night before my night shift, and then I finished it the next morning. The next afternoon when I woke up from my night shift. So, like, it took me 5 hours. It took me 5 hours to finish this game. It's mad. Like, the game's good. The game's, like, pretty alright. It's fine. But, yeah, it only took me 5 hours. Like, people were kidding when they said it was, like, really short. I'm really glad I didn't buy this, like, when it came out at full price or anything, because, like, I heard that it was really short, and I thought, I'll skip on that then. And, yeah, I'm glad I got it for free, definitely, on PlayStation Plus. But, as a game, like, it's pretty cool. I mean, I definitely prefer the remakes of 2 and 4 way more. Like, them two are incredible. Them two are absolutely incredible remakes. They're awesome. Like, really true to the core games, and but, like, properly graphically improved and, like, just filled with, like, dread and, like, horror and all that sort of stuff. But with Resident Evil 3, it feels slightly detached from the original version. I love the original Resident Evil 3. It's incredible. It's one of my favourite games ever. And I just couldn't help but feel, like, really disconnected from the original game. I mean, the core sort of, I guess, you know, like, the core storyline, like, was very, very similar. But the whole layout of it all and everything was just way different. Like, you're just, like, you weren't doing, like, the same sort of, like, alleyways and, like, going through, like, the mansion first thing at all. Like, it was not like that. It just felt all very unfamiliar, and I was kind of having, like, I was kind of playing it thinking, did I miss this playing the original, or is this just completely different to the original? And I think it's definitely the latter. Like if I'm playing a remake, I would at least like to see some, like, links and stuff like that, but, like, it just felt so, like, disjointed from, like, the original, that I just wasn't really vibing with it much. I don't really dig the look of Nemesis either. Don't really dig the look of, like, the remake Nemesis. I way prefer the old one. Like, he looks way more badass and scary. But, I mean, the game itself was fine. Like, it still looks good. It still plays well. And, you know, I played it in standard difficulty. Put it down to assisted, like, when it started getting really, really hard, when you're all trapped in the hospital. But if you know that bit, what I'm on about, loads of zombies start getting you, and it's very, very much hell on. So I just went down to assisted because I'm a bit of a baby. I said it before, I'm not a good gamer, but yeah, it was fine. It was fine enough. Like, 5 hours, I would much prefer a full-on fucking remake. Like, remember how you started off Resident Evil 3 last time? Well, here it is again. Going through all those alleyways. Going in the mansion again. And then fucking, you know, looking for those emerald bits. And, like, going up to the clock tower. All that sort of shit. Activating the bell. It was just, like, it was completely rushed and disjointed. Yeah, it's just nothing like Resident Evil 2 remake or Resident Evil 4. But, like, you know, probably a, if I was to mark it out of 10, probably a light to a decent 6. I don't totally hate it. But, yeah, that's how I feel on it, basically. That's how I feel on it. I might play it again. I don't know. But I'm not in any rush. Like, I would, like, if you was turned around and said to me, like, you need to just play Resident Evil 2 Remake now. Or Resident Evil 4 Remake. Now I'll be like, okay, pass me the fucking controller. Resident Evil 3 Remake, I'll just be like, can I play something else? You know? But yeah, that's all I got to say about Resident Evil 3. And I have started Final Fantasy 4 Rebirth. It finally came in my house a couple of days ago. And my God, I'm loving this game already, man. I mean, I have talked about Final Fantasy VII Remake before, a few months ago when I finished it earlier this year, and I do really like that remake, but this seems a lot more different. Like, this seems way different than the remake. I mean, obviously, this is, like, this is, like, part two of Final Fantasy VII as a whole, as a remake, so Rebirth is the second part of that. And it looks absolutely stunning. It looks incredible. And, like, they've added some more things in, like the Queen's Blood card game and everything else. And, No, more side quests and stuff. Like, it looks incredible. It looks absolutely incredible. And just, you know, the music and everything and just how it's all set out. Like, the free roaming aspect of it. Like, it is just unbelievable. Like, the Final Fantasy VII Remake is definitely way more linear, where this one feels a bit more open. And, yeah, this is fucking brilliant so far. I'm looking forward to playing it some more and talking some more about it, because I have a feeling that I'll spend a lot of time on this, like doing side quests and that sort of thing, and collectibles, that sort of shit. Like, something that I would do for a game like Breath of the Wild or Tears of the Kingdom, or, you know, Skyrim, one of those type of games. And yeah, I think it's truly, truly fucking special. So yeah, that's Final Fantasy VII Remake. And just before we draw the podcast to a close, I've got some questions to answer. So, coming off the back of the Slam Dunk announcement, we have a question from Haley. And me, I remind you that if you want to ask any questions for the podcast, you can do that by following me on Instagram. I do upload Instagram stories, and when I do, it's usually the day before I start recording, like maybe like the Wednesday or the Thursday. And I'll put in like a question box, that's a band, a question box, so that you can ask me any questions for the podcast. And you can do the same by joining the Master Dan Discord. So it's got there's a Mastercast channel in there, and every now and then I'll just mention to everyone that I'm about to record the podcast if you want to get any questions in there. And this week, we're actually jam-packed full of questions. It's really good. So, Haley has asked, let me just get the question up. There we go. Where's it at? Who are you most looking forward to at Slam Dunk, and who do you hope is getting added to the lineup? Okay. So, looking at the lineup at the moment, for fuck's sake, I did have it just there. There we go. Looking at the lineup at the moment, I feel like I just got to go straight from the path. Straight from the path are just a band I absolutely love. They're the one I'm looking forward to the most. Even though I've seen them like quite a lot of times, they're just fucking right up my street. In terms of bands being added to the lineup, this is a good question, Haley. You know what, I don't know. It would be cool to see a bit more hardcore representation in there. Maybe a band like Guilt Trip or Military Gun. Slope is a band I mentioned on the podcast before. Their album Freak Dreams is incredible. Would love to see them on there. If we're going for any more like heavy shit, I don't know, maybe a band like Speed would be good on there, or Turnover. Yeah, so just some good hardcore representation. You know, in terms of like sort of like punky kind of stuff, like I really enjoyed the Hotel Era Outbreak, but I can't imagine them coming back. Like Joyce Manor would be a good fit. Let's see, Super Heaven, maybes, I don't know. I mean, I'd say Creeper, but they've done like everyone for the past few years. I wouldn't say no to Creeper playing there, of course. So I think that is it for me, I reckon. And let's say we have a secret band. Let's say we have a secret band playing there. Who would you want to be a secret band playing the festival? Someone who's like pretty big. You know, we've had the likes of McFly and Busted play there as a secret band. Who should we have? Oasis, fuck it. Let's have Oasis as a secret band. Ha ha, I didn't pay 150 quid a ticket. I saw them for free at Slam Dunk. I think a good secret band would be... I don't know. But yeah. It's a good lineup. Yeah, those are the bands I'd want to have on. Give me some Military Gun. Give me some Slope. Give me some. What was I say before? Is there turnover? Turnover, that would be a good one. Turnover would be a good addition. Yeah, just give us some just give some good bands, mate. Give some good bands, mate. But yeah, I struggle to see what other big bands would be added on, really, because it looks like there's a lot of big bands on there already. But yeah, that is from Haley. Thank you very much for your question, babe. Go on to Instagram now. We have a question from our good friend Jake Carr Smith, our ex podcast host. Not ex podcast host. He's just, you know, he has posted on the podcast before. Shut up. Anyways, he has responded to my question as fries, chips, curly fries, or wedges, mate. Asking me which chips I want. I'm a wedges guy. I freaking love wedges. Absolutely love them. If you get them like really nice and crispy, and there's a good like relish or like tomato sauce or garlic dip or whatever, I love wedges. Just a bit more volume to my chips. I like it. Especially if you get them like nice and fluffy on the inside. Yeah, love wedges. Love me your wedge. But you know, I don't hate fries either. Love chips. Love curly fries. I love all forms of potato, mate. Love it. Love them all. And the last few questions, of course, come from our good mate, Six Health Fury. They are on the Discord. Like I say, if you want to ask any questions, they are all on the Discord. So, I did ask on Discord, like, hello, everyone. I'm going to be recording the podcast tonight. If you have any mad as fuck questions, so he's got some mad as fuck questions, so he's got three. Do you believe in fated events? Fated events. I don't know what he means by that. So he means like horoscopes and shit like that. Astrology. What astrology based event? I don't know. Sometimes things happen for a reason, don't they? I don't know. Sometimes I do. Sometimes I don't. Sometimes everything happens for a reason. I'd like to think. I don't know. This is very, very... I'm not very good at... I need to think about these questions before I started answering them. But fated events. I don't really... Yeah, I kind of believe them. Yeah, why not? Yeah, I believe in fated events. Fuck it. What is your ideal cooking pan? My ideal cooking pan? You know what? I like cooking on the wok. I really do, because you can do absolutely everything on there. And like, in terms of like the smooth top on it, like, feels nice and smooth. Feels great. I like doing eggs on it and stuff. It's just completely non-stick and at ease. And like, you know, I could do a good ramen or whatever with it, or stir fry. I like cooking on a wok. But I mean, if I was to do a full breakfast, I wouldn't use it. But like, It's just ideal. Just ideal. And his last question. How long would it take for spaghetti to rot if you left it in your mouth? How long would it take? I reckon if you kept spaghetti in your mouth, maybe 3 hours it'll take to rot. Like, just completely be like... Maybe it won't. Maybe it won't ever rot. It might take a matter of days, but that wouldn't happen because you'd be dead. Interesting. Can we Google that? Can we ask AI about that? Let's see. I'm going to ask AI now. How long would it take for spaghetti to... rot in your mouth? Let's ask the AI co-pilot. Come on, don't let us down. Here we go. Fucking hell, let's give me an essay. Give me a fucking essay. Spaghetti, like any other food, would start to break down in your mouth due to the action of bacteria and enzymes. However, it wouldn't exactly rot in the same way it would outside your body. Here's a bit more detail. 1. Initial breakdown. As soon as you start chewing, enzymes in your saliva begin breaking down the carbohydrates in the spaghetti. 2. Bacterial action. If food particles remain in your mouth, bacteria will start to feed on them, producing acids that can lead to tooth decay. And 3. Time frame. The process of food breaking down and potentially causing issues like bad breath or tooth decay can start within hours if proper oral hygiene isn't maintained. And then after that, it just tells you how to brush your teeth. It didn't give me it was quite cryptic, that, to be honest. It didn't really give me a time frame. No, I mean, it mentioned time frame in the Fed, but it didn't say how long. You didn't answer my question properly. Nah, he's still nothing. Still nothing. The answer is a complete mystery. Six Alpha Fury, I do apologize. I believe you're gonna have to try it yourself. Anyways, that's gonna do it for today on the Mastercast. Thank you very much for listening to me on episode 57. Swore again. Why is it? What is it about 57 that makes me swear in between the 5 and the 7?
I don't fucking know.
But take care. Have a nice weekend. Thanks very much for listening. I really do appreciate you. If you want to get in touch about questions and stuff like that for the podcast, all the socials are linked in the description of the podcast, like to my Discord and to the Instagram, all that sort of shit. If you want to be in touch, would really appreciate it. And I'll be live on Twitch sometime next week, no doubt. It'll be either Tuesday or Thursday, I'm thinking. I will let you know on the Discord, to be fair. If you really enjoyed the podcast, do feel free to give it a thumbs up and a subscribe on the YouTube and all the other audio podcasts and platforms. Give it a rating out of 5. If you think it's absolute dog shit, I don't blame you for giving you 1 star. Honestly, I'd give it 0 stars. It's fucking rubbish. Thanks very much for listening. New cover coming out. Hope you like it. Hopefully this gives me the confidence to sing more. Unless everyone starts calling it a pile of fucking wank. which hopefully it isn't. I think it sounds fine. Thanks very much for listening. Much appreciated. I will see you next week for episode 58. The new Dave Gilmour album is out tomorrow. And I'll probably talk about that next week because I'm very, very excited. Dave Gilmour is GOAT. So, yeah. See you later, folks. Take care. Stay hydrated. Take all of your vitamins if you're American. And, live life to the fullest. Bye.